What we have here is like the IoT work, IoT networking workshop. We have that like the fourth time now at NetDev. It's always one of the smaller workshops because it's not of that much interest for most of the people, I guess. I'm happy to see that we have like 27 participants. I think five are from maintenance and hosting. So over 20 people at least. That's interesting. That's good. I want to have a small welcome here. So just as a start, so the main people we have here are Alexander and myself. We're coming from the Linux WPAN project, which is taking care about the IEEE 802.15.4 stack in the Linux kernel, as well as the 6LoWPAN part, which is shared with the Bluetooth subsystem. And over the last months, last year or something, Alexander has working a lot on RippleD, which is a small implementation, which he has just presented here, of the APL implementation, basically. So that is what he spent time on lately.
Hello, welcome to my talk about Ripple. It's an IPv6 routing protocol for lossy, low power and lossy networks. That's what the acronym is standing for, LNN. My name is Alexander Aring. Stefan Schmidt is not here, but he also leading the IoT workshop at this conference. And Michael Richardson, he is part of the IETF work group, which develops this routing protocol. And what I was doing is a necessary part for the Linux kernel to have a specific handling there, which cannot be handled in the user space. Yeah. So next slide. It's what's Ripple? Yeah, I mentioned it is a routing protocol for IPv6 only. It's for low power and lossy networks. It's like for IoT devices, small sensor networks, and so on. There's an IETF routing protocol working group, which is role, which specified this routing protocol. And what is my talk about? It is more about, I want to give you a small overview how it works. Sure, there is a little bit more complex behind it. We make a simplification about this routing protocol. It has a tree-like topology with a root node, and the nodes in this topology have only one parent, and nodes can have n childs. There's a lot of out of scope things which are not handled in this presentation, is like self-healing of this routing protocol. It is not handling floating root nodes. That means when a node can switch to become the root and the root becomes a node, or you have also multiple root nodes. This is also not handled in this presentation. And there's also security features and a lot of things more. So what Ripple defines upward routes and downward routes, and two kinds of nodes modes. This is storing and non-storing mode. So I will talk about these two modes, which are the different, because in the Linux there was always the possibility to handle the storing mode, but not the non-storing mode. I will talk about this later, why it was not handled before into the Linux kernel. So to talk about the upward routes in the specific two modes, it works the same regarding of the upward route. What are upward routes? That are what the name already propagated. It is how the nodes can reach the root node. For example, we can see on the left side a very basic, simple topology. And on the right side, we can see a tree-like topology, which maybe Ripple can build up. And upward route means when we see, for example, the node 6, how it can reach the root node. Especially in the root node, you have something like a border router node, which makes, in sense of 6LoWPAN, it makes a translation from a 6LoWPAN IPv6 network to a real IPv6 world. You can imagine that the root node 1 here have a connection to the internet. And all other things is your private sensor networks. For example, for the upward route, there exists a special mechanism in Ripple, which is named parent selection. I make it here at the root, at the node 4. You can see it can decide if it want to have a parent 2 or 3 to reach the root node. In this example, it chose the 2, the node 2, to reach the node, root node, but it can also be the 3 node, or it can also select the 5 node. There's a little bit more handling according, it has also to do something with the hop count to the root node. But if you have a specific selection like in 4, it has also more information are collected, like the link quality between nodes when it's a wireless network, or the count of the dropping of packets and something like that. However, there exists a parent selection, and the parent selection will be done over some ICMPv6 message, which Ripple defines to select a parent regarding to the upward routes. So the downward routes in storing mode, now there's a difference between storing and non-storing mode, is that every child have a VR route, for example, the root node knows all the childs, how to reach all child nodes over a specific VR route. For example, the root node 6 from the node 1, from the view of the node 1, is reachable over 2, but also all subnodes which are apparent has also in their routing table how to reach every node in the subtree. For example, 2 knows how to reach also the 6 over 5, and then everybody, then the whole network can be reached. This has only the a big problem that it's highly maintainable, because if the topology will be changed, you need to update every routing table and your subnodes in 2 and 5 and something like that. And every node need to store a lot of routes in their routing table. This is the difference in non-storing mode. In non-storing mode, the download routes is done only that the root node knows how to reach the child nodes by placing a source routing header into the actual IPv6 packet. And for example, how one can reach 6, it is only placed, this information is only placed in the root node. All other nodes has only a default route for the upward route. And for example, the 6 can be reached over 256. It's then here this path, and over the download routes, everybody can reach the node. So all together with non-download routes and upward routes in non-storing mode, it looks like this. Everybody can reach the node, the root node over its upward route. That's a default route. When it doesn't know it, then it just sends it to the parent. And the green arrows here are the downward routes, which are only placed by the root node. For example, when 4 wants to reach 6, then it goes over 2, and then from 2 to 1, and 1 knows how to reach, that's the root node. The root node knows everything about the topology, and it plays the source router header to reach 6, which is over 2, 5, and 6. The big advantage here is that every subnode has only one route to be set, which is the parent selection route to reach the root node. And it is a less of maintenance because we don't need to update every subtree, every subnode to update how to reach other nodes in chain when the topology is changed. The root node need only to be updated. So the source routing header is what I already said, it's only the root node, which is in case here the one node one will be insert the source routing header. And what I already said is it's IPv6 only. All other nodes need to be handled the source routing header, like 2, 4, 6, 4, 3, except the root node. They need to forwarding the IPv6 header, IPv6 packet according to the source routing information, which is done by doing some address wrapping, and it has also a loop detection by just checking if the same if in the address segment if the address segment are assigned on the root node. I implemented a fancy function there. If somebody is interested in that, you can look into adreconf.c to check on such function. And yeah, of course, it also for little sensor networks and also do some compression algorithm. This compression algorithm is mainly because they share mostly the same IPv6 prefix, and then in the segments you can compress a lot of bytes there to reduce the payload. If you reducing the payload, you also it's a lot of low power, not sending more bytes and also such things. So yeah, and the compression is more according in the segment array of the IPv6 routing header, the source routing header, and the compression is always according the destination address, which is inside of the IPv6 header. And this it basically works that it can elide the same prefix by just saying which bytes are the same. So how I implemented it for the Linux kernel, it is more because we needed to implement the source routing functionality, and there exists already IPv6 segment routing, which is ultra source routing protocol for IPv6. And we just did the same thing. It just has a different use case for sensor networks because the compression and a lot of the loop detection is a little bit different. We also was using late tunnel implementation. It's in inside the IPv6 implementation of the Linux kernel, then what you can do is just say here, for example, here are, when you are in the point of view of the root node, you can just say for destination 6, here are the segments. It just works like the other IPv6 segment routing. And what we currently only support is inline header. That means we don't support IP encapsulation yet, but the Ripple protocol has some use case for this where this is necessary, but we don't support this right now. And yeah, the forwarding is always enabled by, it's always compiled in of the in, inside the Linux kernel. You just need to enable it over the sysfs configuration, and there's just a little helper file ripple.c in IPv6 to offer some compression helpers to compress and uncompress the Ripple source routing header. So according to user space, there exists a experimental, very experimental user space daemon to just prove my work that it works. It exchange IPv ICMP with a 6 message. This is what Ripple is using to share all this information about what is the parent selection of 4, and it's flooding the network with some information. And when every, how it basically works is that the root node stores a tree data structure to represent the topology. So in this case, the root node knows everything about how the topology is built and how to reach every node. And Ripple D is actually holding a tree data structure to represent the topology. And according to this data structure, it also inserts the source routing information. And how it works is basically that every node is first creating all upward routes to reach the node. And then every node will tell about the root node what's their parent. And when the root node knows every node, parent's node, and which node was telling that, it can reconstruct the tree the topology in a tree data structure, and then insert the source routing information according to that. So, and important to say is that the upward route is only a default route to the parent. It's only a default route. So now we coming to a demo I want to show you. So my demo, it is this, it uses the MAC 802.15.4 HW simulator, which can produce such topology, mesh topology, which you saw in the on the left side on the slides. Here it works over namespaces. I named the namespace according to a node ID. One is, for example, the root node, and everybody else are the childs, which are somewhere in the topology. Now I want to show you the routing table of the root node. And for example, I simplificate it here that that the MAC address is according to the node ID. For example, 4 is the node ID 4. And this is the prefix which everybody shares the same. And you can already see when I'm typing this command, I want to show you what I did here. So I'm just doing a ipnetNS exec ip6 route. And you can see on node 4, we have two segments that this is in point of this in the view of the root node. You can reach the node ID 4 over the two segments 3 and then 4. And for example, so the node ID 4 is over 4. There need to be the node ID again in the segment to have a loopback route over loopback. So for example, for 6, which is a more difficult route, you can reach it over the 3 and 4 and 5 and then 6 again. So you can also see we only using link local addresses for the segment. That's what Ripple is using, because in combination also with 6LoWPAN, this is very fully aligned addresses. They are not showing up in the header, and this actually worked because link local is not route, but every not routable, but every node is their direct neighbor. So this still works, and we're using full addresses here. This is how the root node works. It has all these green arrows, how to reach every subnode. What I want to show you as next is one node address, and we only see here the default route, which is the parent selection. In this case, this node has a parent selection, which is 3. How to reach the root node when we also want to look how 3 can reach the root node, and it already say from node 3, the parent selection is 1. So it's directly connected. It has the root node as parent. So what I wanted to show you as next is a trace route. You can see, for example, for 4 reaching 2, which I just want to show you that. It's again from point of view is the node ID 4 and trace out to 2. We see that the first hop is 3, 1. So it's going upward and then downward again to 2, which is the next, which has a parent, the root node, because it has one, because it's the one hop only. And what I wanted to say here, it's a little bit buggy right now, how to reach 4 to 6, but it is working. I can say afterwards why it works. It just stops at the node itself. I need to look into that. But in this example, we can see it goes over 3, then it's going to the root node, and then down again to 3, and then 4, which doesn't show up here, and then 5 and 6. And the reason why it works is because I can still ping this guy. But I think what I saw in my implementation is that the traceroute implementation of IP utils is a little bit buggy in taking the next header chain. There's some, it only works on a specific source route. I need to fix, still patches are still pending to fix traceroute against this, because the next header chain evaluation is a little bit, it doesn't work. I did an ugly hack to make it work. And yes, that's everything what I wanted to show. The big disadvantage of course, from source routing, from non-storing mode, which using source routing, is that every traffic goes over the root node. In storing mode, this is not necessary because every subnode can reach other nodes directly, because every subnode has its own routing table, which knows about all the subtree. All in non-storing mode, only the root node knows that. So the disadvantage here is you have a lot of more traffic, but so far I heard from Michael Richardson, he is working on a combined mode where you can combine non-storing mode and storing mode when it maybe becomes a little bit more complex to deal all with all IPv6 routing tables in a node. And the case here why people want to use that is that they don't need to store all these routes in their nodes, because in case of IoT and 6LoWPAN, you have small embedded devices which don't have a lot of storage to store all these things. And in this non-storing mode, you give this information all the root node, and the root node can be a device which runs Linux. So, and why was it necessary to change something in the kernel? Because all these for routing and to place the IPv6 source routing header, then it need to be handled in the kernel to make it at this point when the kernel creates the IPv6 header, like segment routing as well. And the storing mode was always possible because that's just adding more routes into the nodes. So in the future work, I would say we also want to improve the current Ripple implementation that is not just very experimental. There's a lot of traffic currently to exchange a lot of this routing information over ICMP with 6 message. A lot of overhead is there. This can be reduced. And but this is nothing. This is everything user space. We don't need to. But future work in the kernel implementation is still making the encapsulation support, which is not there right now. Maybe can look up this in IPv6 segment routing. And there's a lot of different Ripple specific things which maybe need also to be handled in the kernel. At least there's also a hop by hop option, but if this is now necessary to create it, I don't know. Mike Richardson said something that it's not necessary anymore, but maybe somebody use it and then at least need to be passed. But how these routes getting placed into the kernel over IP route, it is now supported by just making by just saying encap is Ripple of IP route, and then you can add your segments for this specific node. And yeah.
Okay, hello everybody. Okay, great. I see already there are two questions coming in. Alexander, can you answer them here? So you have to unmute yourself. And then I think we could have like 5 to 10 minutes for questions, and then we can go to the rest of the session.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay.
Do you see the two questions? Chat window or?
Yes. So the first question, what is special in LNN low power and lossy networks that makes it not suitable for standard routing protocols? I think you can always use the standard routing protocols, but it's always it's to have a lot of things to
Let me chip in there. So one of the problems is that with all these wireless sensor networks is that a lot of these things are really mobile, and you don't have really a lot of memory storage or anything on the nodes to keep track on all the different nodes you might connect to. So that is one of the problems to have like a traditional routing protocol. Another one is that it's a lossy network. So there are a lot of frames might get dropped because of the mobility or other aspects. So that is one of the reasons why Ripple was designed in a way that it's better suited for some of these scenarios. You can actually go and use other routing protocols there. I think something like OpenThread used parts of some traditional routing protocols and adjusted them to their own needs as well. I don't know the details about that right now, but it is possible, but you might have higher packet loss.
Thank you. It's also because the memory is also the thing that I heard so far that the non-storing mode is the wider used mode outside, especially in the sensor networks. Because they don't need to store a lot of information into their memory. And the second is what are the main difference between Ripple and the already existing IPv6 source routing here? Yeah, I asked me the same question. I talked with Michael Richardson about it. So he answered a little bit funny because you need to ask, you need to swap it around because the source routing header for Ripple was at first there, and then the other thing was there, the IPv6 source routing was there, was coming up, and he told me they have a kind of different use cases. You saw in my example, I don't use any prefix. For the routing destination, I don't use any prefix. I always used a full address. And you can also do that with the routing thing. And it has a specific handling also for the compression of the source routing header. That just doesn't exist in the other IPv6 source routing protocol, and it also handles things a little bit different. But I already said in the talk with the loop detection, I don't saw that in the other implementation. It's kind of different. The use case is different.
The other main people we have here are from the Linux Can project that are Mark and Alexi. Again, hopefully I don't butcher your name. So that are the main people we have here. Normally before on earlier instances of the same workshop, we had people from LoRa here as well and so on. But this time with all the changing of all the scheduling and so on, it was a bit more difficult to get more people in here. What I am always interested in here, if anybody here in the actual workshop is working on anything related to that, or if most people are just listening in, want to see what's going on there. So if you have something like working on something related to IoT networking on the Linux space, I'm happy to hear. So you can either speak up now or write in the chat or something like that. So that would be interesting. Normally I try to have these sessions a lot more interactive, but it's a bit difficult for me to handle that all here on Zoom right now. Yeah, what are you expecting from the workshop? I would assume most of you just came here to listen in what's going on, the status updates, and see what the people presenting here are talking about. If that's different, if you have like more specific questions on any of these topics, we have a bit of time at the end, or you can just start and ask in the middle of any of the sessions, I think. Okay, let's move on. Yeah, so the first part will be a small status update from my side. One part on the kernel side, as well as on the user space side, what the project has been doing. Okay, so I have to say, Linux WPAN is a really small project. Basically, that's Alexander and myself, and we're doing it in our spare time. So it's not like a big company-driven thing where we have like a lot of patches coming in every day or something. So it's really small. We keep up what is going on in the kernel side to keep up that everything keeps working. And we're doing some work there as well as on the user space whenever time permits for that. So one of the big things I changed was like launching a new website. We had like an old website, which was a bit hard to maintain. Only Alexander had access to it. It was hard to have like the new releases linked there, updates for the documentation and so on. So what I did was like going over to GitHub pages and created one there. So we have like easy access with Git, and we can like extending the documentation a bit easier and so on. So matching that, I also changed the documentation in the kernel to move over to the REST format from the old normal text format we had. So that is now nicely linking in, and I need to make sure that actually that is linked back to the main project page and back. Yeah, we moved over all the existing content and redirected, but we need more content there as well. So if anybody is interested in that, helping, let me know. So on the more technical side, one of the big things we have been looking forward or looking into over the last few months is working on a generic USB device driver. So what we have normally in this kind of networking subsystem is like really small SPI drivers. So it's normally like a really small embedded board where you have the transceiver connected over SPI and some additional GPIOs to have like IQ and some specific toggling and reset lines and so on. So, but we also have like a USB dongle, that's AT-USB, which was really popular for development and testing and so on. But it's really the driver for that, and the firmware is really tied to the device, obviously. But the 15.4 spec does not design as kind of a host controller interface if you compare that to something like Bluetooth, where it is actually specified. So we started to look into that a bit more. So Andrey from Intel, who's working also on the Zephyr project, had started such a driver a while ago, I think like 2017, 2018 or something. And he started based that on the AT-USB firmware, and at added the spec for the USB interface a bit more generic to actually support other hardware from the Zephyr point of view. So what the idea was to have like a Zephyr firmware that actually would reduce this interface or expose this interface, and a Linux kernel driver which actually would use that and then hook into the 1504 subsystem. The project stalled in 2018, sadly. We talked again with Andrei. He has no time right now. But there's been people coming in and wanted to have that. So Chris and Eric came in and wanted to push it a bit forward. And then Kuhn also said he would be interested in helping out with that. So Kuhn would actually work on the driver as well as on the Riot firmware side. And Eric would also work on the driver. And I think Chris and others would work on the Zephyr side for that. So we started to look into the spec we have provided. And try to make it a bit more flexible and extend it to be more, cover more use cases for different devices we are actually seeing in the wild right now. So one of the things we wanted to have is like have an option to provide the capabilities of the hardware and provide them by the firmware during the initial hardware bring up to actually make sure that we say, okay, we have a sub gigahertz device, or we have a 2.4 gigahertz device. We use this kind of channels or band frequencies. We offer this kind of power levels, or we have a permanent address, or all kind of other things that we want to bring up in the initial hardware configuration. So most of these things have been a bit static in the initial spec definition. So that's something we started to look into and extend. And now the next phase will be to actually look into implementing the Linux kernel driver as well as the firmware for the different operating systems. The Zephyr firmware that already exists would need to be updated for the new spec. I hope someone will look into that. Kuhn offered to look into the wired firmware. So then we have support for two different RTOS systems and hopefully many different boards and radios. That would be a really big step forward to us. So have just one driver in the kernel. They can just plug in all kind of embedded boards with 15.4 hardware and then just have it running with the right firmware on that. That would be like a big milestone for us to actually bring that forward. I also would be interested to see if anybody wants to do like bare metal implementations of the USB spec or Contiki implementations of that, but that's really out of scope for me, Alexander, or Kuhn, Eric, or Christopher, or something. So if anybody has interest in that, let us know. We have a normal project mailing list where we can discuss things. Okay, so. Yeah, so the next one will be Linux Can. So at that point, with the next slide, I will switch over and Alexei will give us a short update on what has been happening in the CAN world over the last year, I would say, or months.
Here's Mark. Can I have some words on your
Go ahead.
USB 6 LoPAN drivers?
Yes.
I would like to have something for this, for CAN and CAN FD as well.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, I mean,
probably you should join that, on some mailing list and have a look at the spec.
Yeah, we can do that. But I'm not sure how generic we want to make the spec, but we could at least try to align and learn from each other have to do this. That. Because I still want to have the spec quite low level. We can do that.
Just copy paste it and don't reinvent a spec two times.
That's a good idea. Actually, there are quite a lot of embedded boards with CAN as well. And if they run Riot or Zephyr or whatever other RTOS operating system, exposing that would be really handy for development and testing.
Also. Yeah, or for just for small SIM 32 microcontrollers. €10 small little USB CAN dongles. You don't want to write a separate driver for every implementation.
Yeah, that's good. So I will be a bit more active in towards the end of August again in September or so. That would be a time frame where we can actually talk about that a bit more. So, but I hope that then we are getting a bit more track on our side as well. Okay, cool. That's great. Cool. Anybody else having question on this part of the session? Last chance.
Okay, I think Oleksiy can start. Okay.
Yeah, let's go. So Oleksiy, every time you want to have a new slide, just tell me and I will switch over.
Okay. Hi everyone, my name is Oleksiy Rempel. I am co-maintainer of JUnite J39 stack. I will talk about SocketCAN as well. So if you'll have some questions about SocketCAN related issues, you can ask directly maintainer of SocketCAN, Mark. He is here as well. Please, next page. Mm-hmm. Okay. Just in case, if not everyone knows what is CAN or what is it about, so it is a bit different than typical Ethernet. Well, we are still working with two-wire cable. This differential signal, but it is broadcast medium. Everything is, every unit connected to these two wires will send to everyone and receive from everyone. This medium is regulated with carrier sense multiple collision avoidance. If everything works okay, then there are no problems. It is multi-master bus, and for most vehicle or automotive applications, it is still the one way to go. There are some alternatives like 100 base D1. It is single master bus, but it was designed specially for automotive applications with some special timing requirements. It will create a link within some microseconds or milliseconds. And 10 base D1S, which is almost the alternative. It is multi-drop bus, but it will need some master or head unit, which will give some beacons or tact for other applications, other units. The speed of CAN is usually limited to 1 megabit per second for CAN 2.0, or it is a bit faster with CAN FD or CAN XL. Please, next page. We have 11 or 29 bits in for addresses for CAN ID. The prioritization is done is based on CAN ID field, and we have really limited payload space for classical CAN 2.0, we have only 8 bytes. For CAN-FD, with CAN-FD, we'll have 64 bytes. And it is still compatible with CAN 2 networks. And in the, hopefully in the near future, we will get CAN-XL, which will allow us to work with 2048 bytes. But it is still on standardization phase. Please.
Sorry. Yep. Will CAN XL be backwards compatible or not? Because it sounds difficult to do.
I don't know. Mark, can you say something about this?
CAN FD itself is not really backwards compatible. You can turn a CAN FD controller into CAN 2.0 mode, and probably you can do something with CAN XL controllers as well. But you
cannot. So you don't have a mixed network or something. You have, like, you say, I want to run this mode or this mode. Okay.
Yes, you cannot mix.
Okay, thanks.
Even if
next page, right?
Anyway, next page. Um, With SocketCAN, we have abstraction layer for different hardware controllers. Currently, SocketCAN framework provides three different socket types: CAN RAW, CAN BCM, and CAN J9039. It depends on the application. What do you need to use? For usual use case, you can work with CAN RAW, so you will be able to send any package as is to the CAN bus. With CAN BCM, you have a broadcast manager which allow you to send some package which should be repeated multiple times. It is useful for some kind of keep alive messages or repeated status messages, which is a usual case on CAN bus. So you can save some kind of power by not always copying the same message from user space to the kernel and send it again. And with CAN J9039 socket, you will be able to use the CyanogenMod 9039 standard. I'll talk a bit about this a bit later. To be able to work with different types of CAN, like CAN2 or CAN FD, you should configure it on the socket level. If there are some questions how it's done, we can ask more about it by Mark. So next page. So what is CyanogenMod 9039? First of all, it is recommended practices and standards. It is the first and base implementation or standard for, it was initially designed for tracks and buses. And on top of this standard was added some other extensions, for example, ISO 11783. It is, with other words, it is IsoBus. It was designed for tractors and other agricultural devices. The NMIA 2000 was designed for marine sensors, displays, and other kinds of units for ships and boats. And MILCAN was designed for military vehicles. Mostly, all of these standards are defining a way to provide some kind of plug and play. So you can take two different devices from two different vendors, put it on the same CAN bus, and it should theoretically work, just work. To allow this, these devices have an unique ID or vendor number, which is 64-bit long. Please correct me if I'm wrong. And it will use this ID to decide on which address this device will be configured. After this is done, then there are some predefined groups and device types. So we can immediately understand what kind of device sending this message and how should this message be interpreted. This is needed to be done because, like I said, we have a limited payload size, only 8 bytes. So we need some kind of predefined codes and groups and IDs to make everything possible. Then CyanogenMod 9039 defines a transport protocol which allows us to transfer 1,785 bytes in one transfer. This transfer is splitted in this case, will be splitted into 255 packets, and in each packet there will be only 7 bytes. To recognize this kind of transfer, CAN ID will be used to tell this is transfer protocol, and addresses will be used to tell that this transfer protocol is done between unit 1 and unit 2, for example. The ISO or ISOBus extension, they provided extended transport protocol, which allows us to transfer 112 megabytes in one run. It means it is 16 million packets with each 7 bytes. At the bus speed of 250 kilobits per second, you can imagine how long it will take. Please, the next page. So the socket CAN-J9039 is available since last year. So you can use this starting with kernel 5.4. After this, we got a lot of bug reports, mostly from Google Zeus Scholar. Most of these bug reports was fixed. And we can see increased activity from different users, but mostly only questions how to migrate from old version of protocol, which was pre mainlining, or how to understand the abstraction between low level protocol and actual socket level. If someone here who are using this protocol, please tell us. Next page. Theoretically, this kernel implementation should be able to cover all these four known standard extensions like SciJ9039, ISOBus, NMEI, and MILCAN. Practically, I was working only with first two. If there are some users who would like to have more and test more, please tell. It will be interesting to know how it's working and what is needed to be done to make it work on other types of vehicles. Please, next page.
Just one question on that. So is for these specifications, different groups behind them doing the specifications on, do they offer anything like interop test, plug fest or something like that? Because initially when we did the work for 15.4 on the kernel, that helped a little bit to make sure that we are compatible to other implementations of that, to make sure that we are finding some of the smaller low level bugs where we just had logic errors or something like that in there. In the end, it obviously means that you have to find a developer working on that directly, and then you can have like a real exchange. But this kind of interop test might be helpful. I don't know if they run them or not.
Currently, I don't know about this. One of our customers reported that they have sometimes some kind of plug fest. So different vendors coming together and just plug everything together and see if it's working.
But I think in the same subgroup, not plugging any marine stuff in a tractor or something.
Okay, yeah, okay, no, that's one step further. No, I within the same group, that is fine. I just think, but I think that's also more, as you have said, on your customer, on the product level, where they actually want to design something, making sure it works. But it's good to feed that back into the mainline, because sometimes we just have been just bug compatible with other implementations we worked against, so that helps. Just wanted to raise that. So. Okay.
Suddenly, like I said, we didn't get a lot of feedback about how it's used and if it's working at all. So I started to work at least on own user space implementations. For example, for Isobus, I work right now on Isobus file server. It is defined in the standard, and it is kind of like FTP, but for CAN bus.
So it sounds like Bluetooth OBEX all over again.
Yeah. And I have seen some documentations how it probably should be used, for example, in marine environment, that, for example, for some kind of logging of different sensors and so on. We'll see. There is still lack of infrastructure which need to be created, like decoders for Wireshark and so on and so on.
Okay.
Please, the next page. Some words on CAN BCM socket. It is broadcast manager. It is already available for a lot of time, like Stone Age. So just to recall it, if someone forgets, it is periodically sending some on-chain frames like live packages or status packages for some sensors or whatever. And it is monitoring incoming periodic packages and will notify user space if there is some changes about this. Next page.
Or a timeout.
Yeah, or timeout. There is a lot of work which can be done in the next future. Like I said, for J9039, we can still implement a lot of user space. On the stack level, we need some way to properly extract the address claiming cache. It is some kind of like neighbor cache. Currently, I see some fifing sound. Is it me or someone else? Like by ARM or IPv6, we have kind of neighbor tables. So we have something similar in J9039. And probably we'll need to use some kind of netlink interface for this. There is also some old or quirky buses which should be handled as well. Currently, I have no idea how we will work with them. If someone provides some feedback, if something is not working, then we can take time to investigate how this should be implemented. Test automation. It is the most important topic. Partially, it was started by one of users. We get feedbacks and questions about stack and how it can be implemented on the top of Titan framework, but currently we work only with own scripts and user space applications to do some kind of test automation. Then next thing to be done is time-sensitive networking. Even in the CAN world, we have this kind of hardware. For example, with TTCAN, time-triggered CAN, we can send packages on triggered by some timestamp event. And this is currently not implemented. The hardware for this use case can be found by STM32MP1. So it will be interesting to see what can be done and what not.
Okay, and just to hook in there, sorry, for the time sensitive, that is only on the to-do list. You haven't started any work there, because sometimes we also have like a mode in 15.4 where we have like periodic beacons coming in. We would do like kind of scheduled sending out of packages or something. That so it could be interesting for us as well. But you haven't looked into that, right? Yeah.
Yeah. No, it's the stuff. Oh, the pitch noise is away. It's the stuff we want to use. What the Ethernet guys are using for their time sensitive networking stuff. So you basically need a proper scheduler and support, obviously, in the driver and your hardware, and then you give a timestamp on the packet from user space and. The scheduler knows what the hardware offers, so maybe just a timestamp of 1 second in the future, and then the packet scheduler will push the packet into the hardware just in the right time, so that there is enough time that the hardware can load everything, and then the hardware will take care of sending it out. Okay. That's the principle, and it's implemented for Ethernet, and I think we can use something like this for CAN, or even the same callbacks and mechanisms.
Okay. I mean, we don't really have a high need for that on our side. It just triggered me when I read the specs that we have something like that as well. So I was wondering about it. Thanks.
Time triggered can be probably used for time synchronization, for more exact time synchronization. I don't know what kind of other use cases will need this kind of can. I don't know. Proper timestamps. Currently, we are using timestamps, but most of them are software. Based to make it all work properly, you'll need to synchronize the pre-running timer inside of CAN controller and do probably the same things which are on Ethernet world are done. Currently, I use timestamps provided by lower part in J9039. Stack to notify user space about progress of transfer, because we can push data to the socket much faster than the data will be transferred over CAN. So the application will put a huge blob of data and wait until it's all transferred, and not to block this user space application. We provide an event over error socket to notify that data was transferred or not transferred, or if there are some kind of errors was seen. And like in Ethernet world, we have PHYs. They are much simpler, but they still need some special handling, and currently, we have no implementation for switching PHYs on or off, or switch PHY into listen-only mode, or to wake up it, or to provide some kind of cable testing. So we'll need to investigate if it's possible to at least partially reuse Ethernet PHY framework for this purpose, or we'll need to start something on. Some feedbacks will be interesting to see. I see Andrew Lunis here. Maybe we can talk about this. And one of more interesting topics is hardware filter. And hardware filter should allow us to ignore packets which were sent not for our unit on the bus. So we can reduce some CPU load and interrupt load in the system. Currently, this is not implemented. And I think one point is not seen here is hardware mailbox support. It means we should be able to read only updated package and request from user space. Since the CAN infrastructure is status-based, not event-based, we get all the time status update of some units, and mostly the status is not changed. So we can take a snapshot of latest available status update, and only at the time we need it. Probably Mark can tell more about this.
Yeah, for example, if you are a cluster in a car and want to display the temperature or something like this, and you have a temperature sensor sending the data like every 100 milliseconds, I don't know why, but maybe it is. And yeah, what we think about here is what the hardware supports is that you can set up a filter and filtering CAN ID, so data from the sensor into a hardware mailbox. And usually this would trigger an interrupt, and then you read out the frame, just the usual, and put it into the kernel stack. But if you really are sparse on resources, you might want that message sitting around in that mailbox, and you read it then actively from the controller, maybe expose these mailboxes as industrial I/O channels, so that you only read from the hardware if you want to. So you get the latest packet, or the latest status, and not all the statey in between that are not interesting for you. At least this is how some CAN applications were designed back in the days when there were still microcontrollers and no operating systems, and maybe there are some customers who want to have something like this. It was just a rough idea I had while taking a shower also. I think that's it for this slide, and the next one is a big, have your questions, right? Yeah, are there any questions?
So we have like 30 minutes left. So I think we could start with questions on the CAN part. And if there are none, or if they are trickled down, then we can go back and see if there are any more questions on the 15.4 or Ripple part. So just start with CAN now.
Ethernet five maintainer. So yeah, I was interested to see you considering reusing Ethernet PHYs for CAN PHYs. There's nothing I know of that should stop that from working, but as usual, the devil's in the details.
Yeah, usually CAN PHYs are really simple, have probably mostly no internal state machine, and mostly they are controlled by some external signals over some pin or some voltage controller or something like this.
Usually GPIOs.
Yeah, usually GPIOs. Yeah.
That would normally all be hidden in the PHY driver itself. I think the API between the PHY core and the PHY driver shouldn't really care if it's CAN or Ethernet. So I think it could work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we'll have a look and see how many has to be implemented of these callbacks, and what about the state machine, or where is the state machine for the...
The state machine actually becomes very simple if you say you don't implement auto negotiation.
Yeah, we don't have
which, to. Yeah, so I suspect it should just work so long as you tell it there's no auto neg support. And it will control the carrier for you if the PHY can tell you the carrier's up or down.
Usually not.
I suppose because it's a shared bus, you don't actually have a peer, so you don't know if you're connected to anything.
Yeah,
Yeah, so you probably just need to always report the carrier is up.
Yeah, yeah. The carrier is actually down if there are too many errors on the bus. The scan has a self-healing mechanism. So if a node sees an error on the bus, it increases some internal counters. And if these counters reach some threshold, it says, okay, everything is broken and I'll leave the bus. It's a self-healing mechanism.
So I'm guessing the Mac does that, not the Phi.
Yeah, it does not do... It's not the Phi, it's the Mac. Yes.
Yeah, so we have to be a little bit careful that normally the Phi assumes it's in control of carrier. And in this case, it's not.
Yes, and because we don't use a Phi framework yet, we get an interrupt from our Mac, and it says, I'm in bus off. This means the controller has said too many errors, I'm leaving the bus, and then we do the EF carrier down, or what's the callback, this function call, so that upper layers get notified that we are not on the bus now. But some bigger automotive files, they have the functionality to sense if there is some problem on the bus, like a shortcut of wires and so on.
Yeah, so that's where the recent Phi cable test would be nice.
Yes, yes.
And again, that's generic. It doesn't care if it's how many pairs are there. It doesn't try and send any frames or anything. So, yep, that should also work.
Yeah, I've looked with Alexei at the patches he provided for this KSZ switch stuff. Was it KSZ? Yeah, the ones Alexei provided in your review for Ethernet. Yeah, I think in a month we at the company have a week where we can will hack on stuff, and Phi framework is probably one of the things we look into.
Okay, if you have questions, feel free to ask.
Thanks.
Okay. Do you have any more questions on the CAN part of the session? I'm not seeing any more raised hand or questions in the group chat. Okay, so do we have questions on the earlier parts of the session, like RippleD on the implementation of the kernel side, or the updates on the 15.4 kernel side? Anything there?
Again, coming back to the USB spec. So you have Zephyr on the client side of the USB, right? Wow, this was an option you...
So the original target for WPN USB, the driver, was for Zephyr, for the Zephyr operating system. So they wanted to have like their networking stack exposed and using the USB interface to run that on the Linux kernel driver. So that was the main idea they have. So it's basically like the RTOS providing the firmware, and that started with Zephyr, but now we would actually like to have like Riot and other ones as well. Sorry, I'm not sure if that occurs. So yeah, what we have, like the initial spec we got from Andrei from Intel was like a little bit too hard coded to what devices they have had in Tree at that point, like many years ago, I could actually offer, or maybe a bit too much tied to their own networking API. So there was no capabilities like if it's a sub gigahertz transceiver, what kind of frequency bands it was operating in, the power levels, and the permanent address and all these kind of things, but there's more than that. So what we wanted really was, in the initial startup, when we query the device, we want to have like some sort of capabilities we get to the host driver. I'm still not sure what path to take there. So I thought we could go with like a bit field with all the different options we have, and have something like tables for different frequency bands and power levels that are specified in the actual standards, and then just reference them from the bit field. Or if you want to go a bit more like higher up and provide the power levels, frequency bands and everything like a bit more directly from the firmware to the driver. I haven't decided that what to do there yet. But that is one of the big things we want to change. Then we want also have like the product, the USB interface version, so we can find a way to later on extend it if there is need for that. But besides that, it's really, I mean, it's a simple protocol. You have like channel setting, you have things like what power level you want to do, and the whole interaction between the transceiver and the stack is really not that difficult. You have things like where you can set it into in a master mode kind of, or in a permanent what's the name again? Anyway, you have like different modes you can set it in. That's what the hardware supports, but that's not too difficult to do either. So in general, the spec shouldn't be too hard to adapt to other things that are simple, like CAN, for example. So, but we also have things like a bigger MTU for standard extensions, which is something like CAN XL also comes into play here. So,
yeah. Do you have transmission completion notification?
You mean coming back from the actual file to the driver? We have that, yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
But in general, the number of the callbacks we have is like really not that complicated. So I think that should be something good. I think the generic parts, like the query of the capabilities and other things, that is something where we can really see how we can share that. The other parts are really protocol specific, but that's easy to interchange, I guess.
Yeah. For CAN, quite important for us is, I don't know if it is for you, that we get the packets received and sent in a correct order. So in CAN, good hardware okay. has timestamps both on received and transmission packets.
Yeah,
so we then can sort it in the order that was seen on the wire, or in your case, on the air.
Okay, we don't really have that use case. I mean, there might be use cases for users out there that want to have that, but the spec does not really have that. As far as I remember, I hope I don't say something wrong here. I'm not 100% sure, certain, but I don't think we really have that. There's another question on TSN on CAN. I think that would be great to get that answered before we have to close. It's in the chat window.
Yeah, the chat says it's from, I'm going to butcher names. Rahul.
Just say Rahul.
Rahul. Regarding TSN on CAN, what are some applications that need timestamping TSN, TX scheduling support that push packets on CAN? So there is hardware support for time triggered CAN, and some people use it. They have upper layer protocols that make use of time triggered mode. Because as you remember, we have a shared medium here, it's a wire, and there is collision avoidance, and the packet with the lowest CAN ID wins. So scheduling on the bus is deterministic. When you have two packets, but you maybe even though want to have a time triggered mode so that you can sure how your bus is organized. And so it's cooperative, I think, time triggered. And then you use your bus in a time triggered way so that you don't back off and try later. because you have a time slot on your own. So it's more deterministic, the whole CAN network. When you have too many stations sending messages from here and there, with time triggered mode, when there's a time slot for you, you can be sure when you get your packet out.
I can imagine that this functionality can be used for precision time protocol to synchronize different units as precise as possible. I know that with proper implementation, it should be possible to synchronize units under microsecond range. And the typical use case for CAN was some microcontrollers, MCUs, in different to Ethernet stack. So they don't need a lot of code to manage and more predictable execution path. So just imagine that, I don't know, some huge 3D printer connected with over CAN, all paths connected over CAN. So every unit should work independently, but synchronized time base and doing some common stuff.
Hi, this is Rahul here. So my question was, like, we have precision time protocol on Ethernet, yes. So will that be running anytime on CAN also? Or there is audio-video bridging standard, which has a lot of stream reservation protocols and stuff like that, and that needs L2 layer scheduling to be in the hardware or thing like that. So for that, it's everything on Ethernet, right? Ethernet and the MAC layer, that is different. So will it be running on the CAN also? And will audio-video packets go on CAN anytime? I was curious about that, yeah.
Probably not, because the packets are so small. Remember, in normal CAN, you have like 8 bytes per packet. I think it's used in really time-critical stuff, like when you have a ECU controlling your motor and your car, when you have an old combustion engine, where some parameters need to be transferred in a really timely manner. So you may use time-triggered CAN in these kind of applications, where you want to be sure, or have to be sure, that your parameters that some controller calculates gets transferred in time to the actor, because otherwise your combustion would be bad, or some other moving parts would be damaged.
Okay, all right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, so I think that was the last question we had here. We are a little bit over time, so that's fine. With that, I want to thank all of you. Thanks for participating, thanks for talking, and I think it actually went quite well. I was a bit worried in the beginning doing this all was in a virtual setting, and I really hope that we have like a face-to-face session at some point in the future. We will see how that goes. Okay, with that, I hope everybody has a rest good of the day. Look into other sessions, and see you there. Bye.
Bye.